Hello everyone, welcome to Analog IAS Current Affairs Analysis for 18th November 2019. These are the articles for the day and these are the sources. A small note, I've also taken an article from Sunday's edition of The Hindu and this is the source. The first article for the day is titled The Fountainhead of India's Economic Malaise. This is written by our ex-Prime Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh. Now there might be a political connotation for his essay, but that is not of relevance for our examination. What is relevant is the tone of the essay or how he is trying to establish the principles between state and citizen and the nature of social contract, or what are the agreed principles between the state and the individual for a successful and prosperous life. There is a theory of justice proposed by John Rawls where he focuses on a concept called distributive justice. What is this distributive justice? It is based on a society being a system of cooperation for mutual advantage between individuals. Justice is the most important political value as it applies to basic institutions of society. Now, as an economist and also as a responsible leader from the opposition party, he is criticizing the government for economic slowdown. Now, how can we say that there is an economic slowdown? He quotes a series of figures. There is a 15-year low GDP growth, unemployment at a 45-year high, consumption of households which is at a 4-decade low, there is bad loans problem at banks, and electricity generation has hit a 15-year low. These are various indicators he has been quoting to say that economic slowdown is not a narrative but a hard reality. Now he quotes a non-economic reason for this slowdown. He says that the nation's state of economy is a reflection of the state of its society. Our present day society, according to Dr. Manmohan Singh, is marked by erosion of trust and lack of support system for people to seek refuge against unlawful tax harassment or unfair regulations. So he says that there is a deep sense of mistrust between entrepreneurs and the government, and this is leading to policy instability. And this policy instability is because of the government's perception to look at every entrepreneur as a crony capitalist. Dr. Singh also warns that if the present trend continues, there is a risk of stagflation, where the economy is characterized by continued increase in inflation combined with stagnant demand and high unemployment. Now, in this context, let us remember a quote made by Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi said that the moment there is suspicion about a person's motives, everything he does becomes tainted. Now, in order to attain the ideals of distributive justice as envisaged by John Rawls or even Dr. Amartya Sen to some extent, we have to look at the conditions prevailing in the society and ensure that our social fabric is not characterized by suspicion and mistrust but that of harmony. That is what Dr. Singh is trying to say. And in this context, if you apply it to economic sense, a stable economic policy is a point for ease of doing business. If there is a stable economic policy, more FDI would come into the country and more jobs would be created. That is what Dr. Singh is essentially implying. So, in the context of philosophical essays dominating the scene in the last couple of years in UPSC, let us try to extrapolate the concept applied here, the concept of social capital, and try to attempt this essay. Social capital can achieve what other forms of capital can't for the idea of India. I want you guys to attempt this essay and comment in the comment box. The second article for the day is taken from The Hindu and it is titled The False Allure of English Medium Schooling. This is regarding the 12,000 crores Nadu Nedu program of the government of Andhra Pradesh, which decided to go for English medium schools across the state. The Chief Minister of the state, Y.S. Jagan Mohan Reddy, has said that the government is trying to overcome the challenges and clear every hurdle as the goal is to meet the requirement of what the fast-changing technology in the world expects from the youth 10 years from now. Though this seems like an ideal scenario, this article presents certain important problems with the approach. The government's decision is based on a couple of beliefs. The first one being, English medium schooling can guarantee good jobs. The second one is that even middle class families are shifting their children from free government schools to private English medium schools, and there is a trend of private schools and the burden of increasing fees. The government is trying to arrest this trend and increase enrollment in government schools. There are certain issues with this approach. Now let us have a look at these issues. Research says that if a child speaks or understands the classroom language and engages with the concepts, ideas and information that he learns in the class, it would be easier for him to learn that particular concept. Research from India and across the world shows that children who get educated in their mother tongue learn better than those who start schooling in a new language. That is the first problem. Now, they are also ignoring the evidence, because for the middle class, it is very comforting that their poor children are getting English education and they might have better prospects in jobs. Even for politicians, it is a win-win situation because they can gather votes. But if you have to focus on research, no state government can claim that a majority of teachers who are themselves educated in vernacular education can make up for the lack of their English skills. Not even the ones who are teaching English. They don't even have the expertise to train kids in English education, and no amount of short training sessions can help them. That is what this author is saying. At the heart of all this is the problem of inegalitarian society, where the conditions, the socioeconomic conditions of the children from which they come is not taken into consideration while designing a curriculum or the syllabus or the textbooks. The bigger problem now would be that the students have to cram this English textbooks or go for ready-made guides and answer sheets where prepared answers are doled out and all they have to do is by heart them. This would propagate a culture of rote learning, and the critical power of assimilation and reasoning would be diminished. The end result would be disastrous because they can neither develop a hold over English nor Telugu, which is their mother tongue. So, if the government wants to really empower kids with English education, they have to focus on programs that increase the reception of new language at an early age. For this, you need to overhaul the teacher training regimen and go for long-term measures rather than going for short-term training courses and imposing English education on kids. That is what this article is trying to say. Now, try to answer this question. Discuss critically the policy of anglicized early childhood education in Indian context. The next article is taken from The Hindu, titled Back to the Rajapaksas. This is in the context of the election of Gotabaya Rajapaksa as the head of the state of Sri Lanka, who is considered as a hero by many, but also is considered to be a perpetuator of war crimes by the other side. So he attained a decisive victory by a huge majority riding on the anti-incumbency wave. There is a trend of right-wing governments or the conservative governments backed by the majority across the world, and this is yet another instance of this conservative government formation. Now, the bigger question that is relevant for India is how this will impact India-Sri Lanka relations, because Gotabaya Rajapaksa has been allegedly having a pro-China tilt even before he was a elected head of the state. For Sri Lanka's majority Sinhalese Buddhist, President-elect Gotabaya Rajapaksa is the best place to take on the hard challenge of defeating enemies of the state, such as those who carried out deadly Easter Sunday attacks earlier this year. For others, he is a leader who should be tried for war crimes over the allegations of killings, torture and disappearance of many people during the final stages of the civil war against Tamil Tiger Seelam in 2009. Rajapaksa is the younger brother of former President Mahinda Rajapaksa, and the two nationalists gave the military a free hand to crush the Tamil separatists and end a 26-year civil war that left more than 1 lakh people dead. Now, the president-elect who won Sunday's election has vowed to drain the swamp of religious extremism that bred the homegrown Islamist suicide bombers who stuck churches and hotels in April, which killed more than 250 people. He plans to rebuild the security regime and rearm the state, including its intelligence cells and surveillance networks. In this context, what is relevant for India is the geopolitical significance of Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka is a location with a list of highly strategic ports located amongst one of the busiest sea lanes of communication. Sri Lanka's Colombo port is the 25th busiest container port in the world, and the natural deep water harbour at Trincomalee is the 5th largest natural harbour in the world. The port city of Trincomalee was the main base for Eastern Fleet and British Royal Navy during the Second World War. Its location can thus serve both commercial and industrial purposes, and it is also used as a military base. So, post-2015, there has been a trend where Sri Lanka started relying heavily on China for the port city project, and the continuation of Chinese-funded infrastructure projects in Sri Lanka has suddenly witnessed a surge. This has been a cause of concern for India. So, let us have a look at what are the political relations with Sri Lanka. As a country that emerged from a civil war facing human rights allegations, the domestic policies and international relations of Sri Lanka are heavily geopolitical, with foreign powers having vested interests. Sri Lanka is also a member of regional groupings like BIMSTEC and SAARC, in which India is playing a leading role. So, former President Mahinda Rajapaksa took Sri Lanka closer to China and sidelining India's concerns, including over the rehabilitation of Tamils in the long-running Sri Lankan civil war. Now, the return of Rajapaksas again is going to bring back this trend. We also share a significant trade relation with Sri Lanka because India is Sri Lanka's largest trade partner globally, where we export nearly 5.3 billion worth goods to Sri Lanka. Owing to the shared cultural history, India also can engage and extend its soft power to Sri Lanka, and the recent Indian Technical and Economical Cooperation Scheme and the Colombo Plan, India also offered 370 slots annually to Sri Lanka nationals under its e-tourist visa scheme also. So, there is a goodwill gesture in the form of visa fee sharply being reduced for Sri Lankans. So, we are also engaging in soft power engagement. There is a significant presence of Indian community in Sri Lanka, which is made up of communities like Sindhis, Boras, Gujaratis, Memons, Parsis, Malayalis, Telugu people, apart from the traditionally settled Tamilians as well. Though their numbers are much lesser compared to the Indian origin Tamils, they are economically prosperous and well placed. Each of these communities have their own organization, their festivals, and that is the reason why India's diplomatic engagement must reach out to Sri Lanka as well. On the front of defense and security cooperation, Sri Lanka and Delhi have a long history of security cooperation, and we conduct military exercises like Mitra Shakti and naval exercises like Slinex. So, keeping in view all these important aspects, we have to contain this pro-China tilt and work towards resolution of issues like Hambantota or the Chinese involvement and the supply of arms, as well as the provision of huge loans to Sri Lanka for its development. There is also issue of Sri Lanka's first nuclear partnership with China. And to contain all this, India is also investing in Sri Lanka's infrastructure development in the northern and eastern provinces. India is also trying to build a Trincomalee port to counterweight the Chinese developments at Hambantota port. Smaller issues like demarcating the international maritime boundary line to solve the fishermen's issue must be taken up with priority. And as a way forward, both countries should create a democratic setup where there is a scope for broadening and deepening these ties. This article is taken from The Hindu, the Sunday's edition of The Hindu. I felt it was important and it shouldn't be missed because it has some prelims worthy information as well. So it is titled, What are the surveillance laws in India? This is in the context of the attack of Pegasus spyware, where there were reports of Indian journalists and human rights activists being spied upon by the usage of a malware called Pegasus by an Israeli company, where even the people who were the victims of this attack were not aware. It created a problem of zero-day vulnerability where even the software provider WhatsApp and the hardware provider, in this case the Apple, were not aware of any such malware, and this created a huge outcry regarding the state of privacy in our country. In this context, The Hindu came up with an informative piece where it tried to put down the legal basis for surveillance activities by the government in India. Also, last year, the government came up with a notification that it is empowering 10 security agencies to carry out surveillance. Of course, with the mandate of a Home Secretary. But this has been challenged in Supreme Court. Now, what is relevant here is the information regarding those 10 security agencies, because we have in our syllabus in GS3 a topic called security agencies, and it is important to know the basic information of all this for our prelims as well. Now, what is the surveillance framework? If you want to tap calls, it is the Telegraph Act 1885, and if the government wants to carry out surveillance online, it is the IT Act which empowers the government. Now, this act also specifically says that hacking is totally prohibited and only the government officials are empowered to carry out the surveillance, and that too on a case-to-case basis with the permission from Ministry of Home Affairs. That is the important key takeaway from this article. Now, the article also says that India is the third worst performer with respect to ensuring data security after China and Russia, because there is no law that ensures data security and cyber security, and there is no grievance mechanism available in our country. So the government must work towards creating that legal framework for data security and cyber security. The next article for the day is titled A Jan Andolan for Nutrition, and this is taken from Indian Express. This article is written by the Minister for Women and Child Development and also the Minister for Textiles, Smriti Irani. So the writer talks about the paradox of how the impressive rise in agricultural productivity has yet not eliminated the challenge of malnutrition that we see across the country today. The author also quotes a World Bank study which estimates the annual cost of malnutrition in India to be at least 10 billion, because it is driven by loss of productivity, illness and death. There are various other analyses which have shown that in order to achieve the zero hunger in India by 2030, as envisaged in the Sustainable Development Goals of UN, India should liberate nearly 50,000 people from hunger every single day. So this requires a convergence between agriculture and behavioral patterns, because even though the government is trying to supply quality nutrition, there is a significant disconnect because people have been focusing on quantity rather than quality. This brings us to the point that in order to ensure that nutrition, malnutrition is handled properly, it requires multiple stakeholders across the food supply chain, and there is a need to strengthen agriculture and nutrition linkages. To explain this, let me take the case of staple diets across North India and South India. In the northern belt, wheat is considered more or less to be a staple diet, and in the south, it is rice. So, owing to this fact, even when the geography does not support the cultivation of paddy, many farmers take up the cultivation of paddy even though when they are aware of the fact that those regions do not have proper irrigational facilities and proper agroclimatic zones that support this kind of cultivation. So, in order to handle this, the Ministry of Women and Child Development has partnered with Melinda Gates Foundation to create what is called Poshan Atlas. This article is trying to explain the importance of this Poshan Atlas, which is formally titled Bharatiya Poshan Krishi Kosh. This is an initiative that is particularly relevant in this age of globalization because the advent of modern systems has impacted even the food systems and resulted in a loss of knowledge on the consumption of traditional and local nutrient-rich foods in favor of less nutritionist and industrialized and processed foods. This is an important initiative because without understanding social and behavioral cultural practices, we cannot promote healthy diets and reinforce these behaviors, both at individual and community level. As a part of this project, the Atlas is trying to create a repository of diverse crops across 127 agroclimatic zones of the country and ensure that these would be accessible to policy makers, administrators, and even empower the local communities to change their behavior to meet the nutritional outcomes. So this Poshan Culture Atlas will create a repository of traditional foods and people will be encouraged to maintain closer ties between agriculture and the nutrition sector. So this project is an amalgamation of trying to induce a behavioral change and change in agricultural patterns based on local agroeconomy and agroecology conditions. That's it for the day. Thank you.